to do IP remote programming on a multi-site Capacity Plus network, there are some things you need to do. Firstly, the repeater needs to have the IP system settings set up. So if we go in to manage IP system settings, you can see that we've already set this up and we've put in the IP address of the master repeater on the WAN. We've also put in the port number. The next thing you need to do is you need to go into the configuration of each repeater and you need to go to network and you need to make sure that IP repeater programming is enabled. Once you've done that, you can click on save and you can go back to radio view and you need to program these repeaters again with this new configuration using USB, so locally through a USB cable. Once you've done that, then the repeaters are ready to be IP remote programmed. However, since the radio management server or device programmer is connected to the WAN and the repeaters are connected to routers, so they're on their own LAN, you need to go into the router and you need to set up a port forwarding rule, a NAT rule. So we go into the each router and we configure a NAT rule. So we go here, in this case, MikroTik IP firewall NAT, and you can see there I've already got it. We have a rule, a destination NAT rule that forwards TCP ports 50,000 to 50,100 coming in on Ethernet 1 to, it should forward it to this address range here, 192.168.1.something. So this is the LAN, the site LAN. Now, where does this port number range come from? TCP port 50,000 to 50,100. We have to go in to our radio management server and we have to go to the device programmer. So this is the device programmer that will be used to do the IP remote programming. And we have to go into settings and we have to tick IP program, which we've done already. And when you do that, it brings up these settings here. So you have a minimum TCP port and a maximum TCP port. And you will see there that the minimum is 50,000, the maximum is 50,100. So this port range here, these ports 50,000 to 50,100, this needs to be NATed in the router. While we are here, one of the things that you will need to do in the device programmer is to give the device programmer its unique ID. So in this case, I'm using 5. The reason being is that you have repeaters. And if we go back to radio management here, and we go back to the radio view, you will see that the radio ID of the repeaters, so there they are there, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we cannot use 1 to 4. We have to have something unique. So in this case, I'm using 5. So that is a unique device programmer ID. Once you've done that, you click OK. Since you're making changes, it will ask you, do you want to restart? Yes, you have to restart. It will just stop the device programmer. It will start again. Just be careful. Don't do that while you are busy writing a device because it could crash. I don't know what the effect would be, but it's best to do any configuration changes in the device programmer when it's not busy with something. So in this case, you can see nothing is happening, so we're okay. Okay, let's go back to the router. So we have this port, TCP port 50,000 to 50,100. This should be forwarded to the LAN DSTNet to the LAN on this IP address range here, Once you've added that natural, you can just simply click on apply and OK, and it's done. You need to do the same thing on the second side. So this is the other router that you see down. So this is this router here. So we were looking at this one, dot one, and this is dot two here into 172.31.0.2 IP firewall NAT, and you can see that we've already got the rules set up there in the other router, the router for site 2. Right, to use RDAC, we can use RDAC to do different things. We can get status information from the repeaters, so we can do things like measuring the signal strength. And we could use, for example, measuring the RSSI of the repeater when there is no traffic on the channel to determine, let's say, the ideal value for the RSSI threshold in radio management. Okay, like the kind of squelch of the repeater. So to connect to the repeater using RDAC, we need to get RDAC set up to talk to the system. So the first thing we need to do when we start RDAC is we need to go into systems and we need to click on add. Now, what are we going to add? Do we want to add a local connection? Okay. Or do we want to do remote? We want to do remote because we're going to connect through IP. Local means you're going to connect to the repeater locally using USB, just the programming cable. So we can click on remote mode, we click on add. Then we're asked, what type of system is this? Well, in this case, it's a multi-site capacity plus system. The setting here, they haven't changed it. It still shows link capacity plus, but link capacity plus and multi-site capacity plus are the same thing. We need to put in an IP address. We have to put in the master repeater IP address. So we have to put in, we cannot put in this 192.168 address. We have to put in the WAN IP address because this PC that we're running RDAC on is connected to the WAN. And so to connect to the master repeater, it needs to go to the router. The router will then NAT the traffic through to the master repeater, and then it can do its stuff there. The master UDP port is 50,000. We saw this in radio management. If you go to the master repeater and we go into link establishment, you can see that this is the master repeater and its UDP port, it's 50,000. Okay, so 50,000. RDAC ID, so this is like the radio ID of RDAC. This needs to be unique, and you saw there the device programmer, it has a radio ID of 5. So in this case, I'm going to make RDAC give it an ID of 6. The RDAC UDP port, so this is the UDP port of RDAC itself. You can leave it as 50,000, or if you want, you can change it. I don't see any reason why you would want to change it. You can leave it as it is. Then if you're using authentication at the IP level, you can put in the key in there if you want, but there we are not using authentication here, so we can leave that out. This firewall open timer, we can leave this as it is. This is just like a kind of a message that RDAC will send to the master repeater just to keep the connection open if you are using a firewall. That's okay. Once you're happy with the settings, you just say okay. Then you go back here to connect, and you can see now we've added this new system here. We just click on sys1. What will happen now is that RDAC will connect to the master repeater. When it connects to the master repeater, it will gather the information about the peers, because the master keeps this information. And once it does that, then it will connect to the peer repeaters and it will get its information. So there you can see it's got the first peer, second peer, and then comes now the third peer. Okay, so you can see that this repeater here, it's got an orange triangle next to it. And that says that, oh, hang on, there is an alarm with this repeater. What is causing it? Well, if you go look across here, everything seems to be okay. Well, the problem here is that there are some fields missing. So we want to add these things in. And so the easiest, in my opinion, is to simply go right button click here at the top of the table and just say show all. That shows everything. Okay, so it's quite big. Some of the stuff you'd probably not want to worry about, because, for example, TX gain alarm, backplane supply alarm, all of this stuff, this is not applicable to, in my case, I have SLR 5500s. So the SLR 5500 doesn't have a backplane like SLR 8000 has. So you can probably hide these, and the external circulator, you can take those off. But what I want to show you here is what is causing this alarm on this repeater here is VSWR. Okay, so it's saying to us that the SWR is high. What we can do now is we can go down to the bottom and we can go select VSWR and we can go query, and you can see that the SWR on this repeater is 124.59. Okay, this is not mega accurate, but it just gives you an indication of what the repeater is seeing. So the SWR in this case is 124. So that says that there is something wrong either with the dummy load that I'm using, or maybe even the dummy load is not screwed in correctly. So that needs to be solved. What I really wanted to show you here is the ability to read the RSSI. So if I look at this this repeater here, the master repeater, now if I click on read RSSI, what it does is it queries the repeater and it gets the RSSI reading. And you can see, because I don't have any antenna connected to the repeater, the RSSI is very low. It's the signal strength minus 127 dBm. Okay, and you can click it multiple times. You can go to all of the repeaters and get a similar reading from them. And you can see there that the RSSI, it's in this case minus 127 dBm. You would, in practice, on a real live system, you would get different values. If a radio was transmitting, this value would go up according to the signal strength of the radio. But what I want to do here is I want to measure the signal strength when there is no traffic on the channel. So you can see here, I'm getting a value of minus 127. What it means is that when I go in to set up my repeater, when I look at the settings of the repeater, and I go into the channel, the multi-site capacity plus channel in this case, I can go here and I can go set my repeater RSSI threshold correctly. As I said, you try to set this level, this value here, to be around 6 to 10 dB above the average noise floor on the site. So here I'm measuring minus 127. It means that I can set this value here, this repeater RSSI threshold in the repeater configuration, to be something like minus 120, minus 115, somewhere around there. That way, the repeater will be able to respond to relatively weak signals, so signals in below minus 100 dBm, and it will work correctly. It will not think that the channel is busy because of some RF noise. That's it for this video. Thanks for watching.